Thank you for clicking on NewsSentinel.com. Multimedia editors Justin, Kenny, Dan Vance here to talk some boys basketball, the unofficial midway point of the season here in mid-January. So we thought we'd hand out some midseason awards. They mean about as much as the end of the season awards. Absolutely nothing, sure. But whatever. We're going to give them out anyway and start with the best player in the area in Northeast Indiana. And I think this is one that there's not much debate on.
Yeah, I mean, it's Keon Brooks. It's been Keon Brooks for a while and will continue to be Keon Brooks for about another year.
How have we seen him develop from his sophomore season to now as a junior?
I think Keon's really learning how to take each possession at a time. He doesn't force as much. Every now and then we see him kind of fall back into some of those underclassmen mistakes. But especially after that Romeo Langford display when they played New Albany, Keon is really making the most of every possession, shooting the ball well, not forcing things, finding his range, and putting up shots that overall are better.
Yeah, and he's helped his teammates get better as well, playing more within an offense. And it's sometimes taking a secondary role to a hot hand of a Lucas Croft or a hot hand of an Austin Boucher, and it takes a lot for a player of Keon Brooks' caliber to say, it's okay if it's not me every night.
Yeah, and I think that also because he has to play different roles on this team. Obviously, a lot of these guys have to adapt to different roles. You don't have a true post like you did last year. You don't have a true point guard like you did last year. You don't have a true spot-up shooter like you did last year. So all these guys have to adapt to roles. Keon Brooks has taken what he's learned from Jalen Butts, from Devontae Kenny, from Mawan Quarles, from Brandon Johnson, who's there now, and made all of their games part of his game.
Yeah, so the Northside junior, our best player, and I think there's not much debate in terms of who that is. Sticking in boys basketball and another top contender in the area, MVP. Who is your MVP most valuable player through the first half of the year?
My most valuable player is Jalen Ball at Blackhawk Christian. What he can do to set people up, we talked about that with Keon Brooks. Jalen Ball sets his team up. He has little offensive explosions here and there. When he needs to, has shot the ball much better than he has in the past, gets to the basket well, but he sets everybody up. Frankie Davidson's game has expanded because of what he can do. Caleb First coming into high school has made an easier transition because Jalen Mull sets him up, and he sets his teammates up to be more successful. We talk about MVP, most valuable to their team. You take Jalen Mull off Blackhawk Christian, they're still very good, but who's that guy that does what he does?
Right, and I think, you know, you mentioned it, being the facilitator, getting the ball to all those talented guys on Blackhawk Christian, he's the guy that makes it happen across the timeline and getting things started in that offense. Anybody else in the conversation for MVP?
Yeah, I think Onye Izakuto from Homestead is right there in the conversation because of what he's done. To take a Homestead team that is very, very good in a half-court setting, you know, traditional slow it down, educated pace, and you throw Oni in there and he can pick up the pace a little bit, more of an SAC style. That's why games with Southside are where they are, part of the reason why they hung in with Homestead for so long, because he's able to play at a different pace and has really picked up his game a lot last
year. Similar in the like couple years ago with Taj Curry. Yeah. He was the guy that was able to penetrate and dish or penetrate and finish. Without a guy like One on the roster, without a guy like Taj Curry, it's a very one-dimensional offense.
Yeah, he definitely adds that extra dimension to it, you know, and helps pick up the work ethic of this team because you have a team that works really hard, and when they get down at times, as you can see in times when they're playing a really faster-paced team, a team that's really athletic, you can see maybe they want to get down, but he goes out there and his work ethic spurns other people's work ethic.
Our best player, our best MVP. Now we're going to go by class. We'll start with the senior class and who our best player, our best senior has been through the first half of the boys basketball season.
Yeah, I think right now it's Austin Boucher playing very good basketball, probably playing the best basketball he's played in high school. And that says a lot. You know, we've talked before, a lot of what Austin did at Southside, he's very skilled shooter, very skilled offensive player, but it was a process of the system. And that system was get up and down the court, shoot, 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 shoot. And a lot of people can score pretty well in that system. So now he's not in that system. He's in a set offense. He has other big-time players around him. Not just other good players, but other big-time players around him. His shooting percentages are through the roof. He's getting to the basket well. He's distributing the ball well. You get him in the corner, especially if you're at Wayne High School, and he's shooting the three, he's hitting.
Yeah, all-around game, he's been able to get to the basket maybe a little more than I expected and finish around the basket in the SAC. So all around, just a very solid year for Austin Boucher, the senior at Northside. Go to best junior, which we already talked about, is Keon Brooks. So we'll skip the junior class because that's just repeating ourselves. Go down to the sophomore group. A lot of talented city players, but we're going to go a little bit outside the area to find our best sophomore.
I think Will Geiger at Norwell has scored at a higher clip than we expected him to. He kind of was under the radar until late last year as a freshman and then kind of started to blossom, but he's putting up big numbers. And against good teams, you know, against Hamilton Southeastern, he put up 20-plus points. He's had, I think he had a 32-point game, had a 20-rebound game or a 19-rebound game earlier this year. So he's putting up good numbers against really good competition. And has Norwell in this conversation in the Northeast State that we didn't expect them to be in at this point.
Yeah, I am very impressive by Will Geiger throughout the first half of the year. You go to best freshman, and I think the top one is obvious, but there's a lot of other guys that you could actually consider and are actually in the conversation. But number one is?
It's Caleb First, Blackhawk Christian. Just put up 20 points on Bishop Luers last weekend and is getting more comfortable. I mean, the kid, game one I was there. I watched him play their first game of the season. He looked a little lost, which you then have to remember, he might be big. He's only 15 years old. This is a whole new experience for him. The jump from middle school basketball to high school varsity is insane, but he's getting comfortable in that role. The impressive thing to me is in previous years, we don't see freshmen contributing at a major point on a varsity roster. And you have Caleb First. You have Luke Goody from Homestead that we've seen. You have Brendan Lytle from Bishop Dwenger. You have Jackson Paul at Cherubusco having some big games. Nalon Thompson at Bishop Luers. Michael Leely at Snyder. Now with some things to change at Southside. Austin Jordan at Southside. Blake Davison at Leo. There's so many freshmen contributing on a varsity level. This class is absolutely loaded.
Do you contribute the contributions from these freshmen? Is just the landscape of high school basketball changing or just a really good class individually or a combination of both?
I think it's a combination of both. I mean, AAU, you know, we'll call it AAU, summer ball is getting bigger. You're playing basketball at a younger age. These kids are picking up basketballs and playing competitively at 6 years old, whereas you pick up a basketball at six and, you know, shoot on your Fisher Price basket when you and I were kids. But you weren't playing competitive basketball on a summer circuit until you were in maybe middle school, but mostly high school. You're playing competitively so young, so the skill level is raised. But also, I think this is going to be a really special class.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to watch Caleb First as Blackhawk Christian, currently ranked number one in Class A, goes for a berth in the state championship game here in a couple months. Okay, going to unsung hero, a guy that we don't talk a lot about, a guy that doesn't get a lot of pub as well. Who did you go with?
I went with James Gardner at New Haven. And he has been talked about over the last couple of years, but I don't think people ever really fully appreciate, unless you're a New Haven fan or a New Haven coach or a New Haven player, what James Gardner does, because he makes an impact on every game in every area. I love kids that do intangible things. He does that and takes it to another level, because if you have a kid who has pass deflections, goes after loose balls, gets steals, has decent assist numbers, they're usually not your prime scorer. He's not the number one option at New Haven, but he's perfectly capable of putting in 15, 20 points a game if he needs to. Rebounds the ball, usually, very rarely is he the tallest guy on the court. And still does all those intangible things. So I don't think James Gardner gets as much attention as he deserves for that.
Yeah, I think a couple other people in the conversation, Brandon Johnson, who I think is an unsung hero for all 4 years of his high school career. Yep. Dylan Redding at Wayne is kind of the guy that gets extremely streaky. And we talk about Craig Young and the talent there. But Redding is kind of the unsung guy in terms of opening up that offense and being a threat from the outside. So a player to watch in the second half. We could go in a lot of different directions for this one. We decided to go in an interesting direction.
Yeah, we're going with Ali Ali at East Noble. And it's funny you say to watch in the second half because he's put up almost 20 points a game. He has East Noble at, I think, 12-1 right now. But still, people don't know as much about Ali Ali and what he can do. East Noble was not the team that was expected to be at the top of the Northeast 8 at any point this season, especially at the midway point. Still some tough games to go, but he's really exploded. And almost like we've talked about with Oni Izakuto doing at Homestead, you take a team that is usually more of a just methodical, more educated pace, and you have a kid like him who can play that pace, but then can take it to another level. And that's why I think that East Noble is standing out right now in that conference.
Yeah, and you know, for a long time, New Haven has been that one team in the NE8 that can play with pace and force teams that largely in that conference like to slow it down, play to their level. Leo, another one when they want to. But East Noble's been able to do that to effectiveness this year thus far.
Yeah, and he's helped other people get to that level. I think that's the difference is At a lot of those schools, you have guys that can play with pace. Logan Cruzy at DeKalb can play with pace, but that's not the team style. New Haven has been able to adjust their team style because they've had those athletes. And you add Ali Ali at East Noble, and he's able to adjust the team style. There's guys on his team that can go at that pace, but that's never been a team style. So now East Noble can say, okay, well, we can run with you if it benefits us, or we can slow it down if it benefits us. And that helps. We've seen that at Homestead over the years. To be able to change your pace and dynamic is huge.
Speaking of Homestead and the Homestead Spartans, and each and every year before the season starts, one of the more hotly contested teams that we talk about are the Homestead Spartans, because so many people want to say, okay, this is the year we see a drop-off because they lost XYZ, and they've been saying it for several years, yet you and I debate going back and forth and say, no, they're not. Yes, they are. And here we are with Homestead Spartans with a chance on Friday to claim sole possession of first place in the SAC when they go to Northside, a battle of undefeated. So in terms of a surprise team, we go with the Homestead Spartans.
Yeah, and you know, they sit at 6-6 right now. But the thing about them at 6-6, there's teams we have behind them in our power poll, Carroll being one of them, Huntington North, who beat this team, being one of them. And you say they have better records, but the reality is that Homestead's capable of beating anybody on any given night. And you can't say that about teams, especially with the 6-6 record. You're looking at that team and saying, oh, maybe they're 8th, 9th, 10th in the area. But they're capable with their roster, with Chris Johnson, obviously, on their sideline, of beating anybody. But it also does surprise us. In the preseason, we had them high. We had them 3 in our first power poll of the season. Then they get drilled by Huntington North. And it's like, okay, this is the year we overestimated them. But here we are again. Homestead having a chance to play for an SAC title. Obviously, they have some games post-Northside that they would still have to win. But to be in that situation, day one, we probably said, yeah, they'll be there. And then, you know, on Thanksgiving, we're all sitting there eating our turkeys saying, oh, Homestead's done. Right. They're not going to do anything. Yeah. So in that regard, it is a surprise. I'm never surprised when Chris Johnson can win. I'm never surprised when he can get the best out of his team. Homestead as a school has a long tradition of succeeding when there's a kid named Buck on the team. So not surprising any of that, but after that first game, and we thought we overestimated Homestead, that's where the surprise comes.
Yeah, and I think consistently year after year, we can say among teams that improve the most from the start of the year to the end of the year, Homestead is always in the conversation. Yep. They continue to grow throughout the year, and this year is no exception with guys stepping up throughout the season. Luke Goody comes in, the freshman, they put him in a spot. After that Huntington North game, Coach Chris Johnson said, you know, we had to get bigger. We put Luke Goody in there at a 6'3". Kind of makes us a little longer, a little taller, and he can hit the outside shot. So how that team has adjusted since that 23-point drubbing, something like that, yeah, at the hands of Huntington North is just tremendous. So they're our surprise team. They have an opportunity on Friday to make even a bigger splash in the area. So you can keep track of the second half of the season and into the playoffs at newscentral.com through each and every day as we have different features coming out. Daily, almost, from Dan and myself and our frog friend Shooter. So for Dan Vance, I'm Justin Kenny. Thanks for joining us.